Good evening. I hate talking over singers. First of all, let's turn all of this straightness into up, because this is a celebration. That's right. We are so blessed to have had Wanda with us for the many years that we did. That's the blessing part of it. She told me one time, a long time ago, she says, I think there's going to be a blessing out of this. And that's what we should focus on, is the blessing. That's right. I'd like to, by the way, my name's Brian France. I go to this small, humble little church that reminds me of my own. And I'd just like to welcome everybody here for this celebration of Wanda Taylor today. And we're glad to have you. And at this time, I'd like to open up as we consult the Lord. Father in heaven, we just thank you, dear Lord, for this day. Lord, this is a celebration day of one of your children that you already have back home with you. And Father, it's us who are left back down here on the earth below, dear Lord. We just like to praise your holy name. Dear Lord, you let us have Wanda for the years that we had her, and what a blessing she was. And dear Lord, we just we want to thank you for that. We want to thank you for life and health and strength. We want to thank you for the safe travels of people that have traveled afar to get here. We want to thank you, dear Lord, for blessing us each and every day. And as we carry on with this celebration, we just hope that when all is said and done, that we will look back and say, man, what a great day we had in the house of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's stand to our feet. We're going to sing He Keeps Me Singing. The words will be on the screen. Throughout this service, we're going to be reading some thoughts and some pages from people that some of them are here, some of them's not here. So I'm going to take off. Jennifer Swenson is a friend that Wanda was connected with through the school. She never was a student, though, and I'm going to read what she had to say, written by Jennifer Swenson Whaley. It says, be intentional. That's what I learned from Miss Wanda Taylor. I never had the honor of being a student in her classroom, but I was her student in life. What did she teach me? She taught me to know my people, to find my circle and love them. Love them to the fullest, to have conversations with people that I have connections with. And two, she taught me that genuine people are those that always know who you are and want to know how you are. That's right. She encouraged me as a teacher and as a librarian. She knew sticking to community roots was important. She taught me to share God's love through my actions and my sincerity. She taught me to take care of my family. She taught me to love my soulmate and to love fearlessly. She was intentional in all aspects of her life. She never realized that she taught me these lessons. I learned them all from her actions through the years. Her life was the lesson. We all need a life teacher like Miss Wanda Taylor. Let us embrace her legacy by being better today, tomorrow, and in the days to come. Be intentional.
Hello, my name's Victor Jones, and I do appreciate you guys being with us today celebrating Wanda. I do want to, I'm going to introduce the speaker, but I want to say this little poem real quick because I think it encompasses her life and everybody she touched. It says, a life well lived. A life well lived is a precious gift of hope, strength, and grace from someone who has made our world a brighter, better place. It's filled with moments, sweet and sad, with smiles and sometimes tears, with friendships formed and good times shared, and laughter throughout the years. A life well lived is a legacy of joy and pride and pleasure, a living, lasting memory our grateful hearts will always treasure. And I am very pleased today to stand before you and introduce a speaker that we feel like was not one and the only friend she had, because she had a lot of friends through her school years and things. But I understand this lady comes way back to the sixth grade. And if you know Wanda Taylor, that was a long, 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 long time ago. So it's going to kind of tell you what the speaker's age might have been. But I would like to ask Susan Thomas to come up today and just bring some words of her friend and sister, Wanda Taylor.
There's a lot of old people here today from my class. Yep, seeing y'all. That's good. Okay, if you can't hear me, say so. And be praying that I don't cry, all right? I just want to say I am so appreciative of the service today and want to thank all of you who got it together. I have my Kleenex. Wanda has been my friend since sixth grade. We just celebrated our 73rd birthday, so she's been trying to keep me straight for a long time, as many of you can testify to that. And I, like many of you, have been struggling with the loss of this amazing friend. Often it didn't seem like it could be true. Sometimes I felt angry at God for taking her. Ronnie and Wendy and Rhonda and their spouses and their grandchildren were all doing well, but they still needed her. So many of us still needed her. But in the past weeks, I've asked a number of Wanda's friends and family to tell me about their relationship with her. And I cannot tell you how much scribbling the things that, believe it or not, I didn't talk the whole time. I let them talk a little bit, okay? Those of you who know me. But that scribbling, it just helped me heal my heart. There isn't time to share. I was going to share everything they said, but Wendy told me to keep it at least within the day, okay? But I just can't tell you how much listening to people talk about Wanda just replaced my anger toward God, and it filled my heart with peace. About the reminders of the rich blessings that she brought to my life and to so many others. Kind of like just has been expressed in those things that were said about her. Listening to people talk about Wanda reminded me of the many ways that she showed us over and over again how to love the Lord our God with all our hearts and how to love others as ourselves. And now something a little bit lighter. It's a kind of a top, sorry Wendy, 15 review. I left a lot out. Okay. Top 15 review of what people shared about Wanda. But to keep me from crying a little bit, I'm going to say one of Wanda's favorite scriptures, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Wanda was an only child, but she had a big family, and there's a whole bunch of them right down there. She was a sister to, good gracious, a lot of people, especially those cousins. Later, she added others, classmates like me and a bunch of y'all out there, in-laws, co-workers, church members, neighbors. She had a lot of family for an only child. She was smart. You can probably testify to that. One of the first things former classmates would say about Wanda was that she was smart, really smart, especially with math. Give her some algebra problems, and she was very happy. She loved numbers. She loved numbers so much that she would try to make some kind of meanings out of billboards, numbers, license plates, any numbers she would see. They would try to not let her see numbers. For example, yeah, as a lot of you know, landline numbers 4663 connected to words that spelled good, G-O-O-D. And that became a cue to use Romans 8:28 in their telephone greeting. And we know that in all things, God works for good for those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. And it was numbers that started the first chapter of the amazing love story of Ronnie and Wanda. You may know the story, but if you don't, it's a good one. 11th grader Ronnie checked and found out that the combination to locker number 13 was the same as it had been the previous year when he had that locker. He put the lock on back. He put it back on, but he put it on upside down and wanted to see who the locker belonged to. Turns out locker number 13 that year was Wanda's. Additional note, it was a bottom locker. Opening a backward locker, that was hard. Opening a bottom locker was not even easy. But crouching down to open an upside-down locker, bottom locker, was hard. And Wanda was used to being punctual. She always was used to being punctual. She's probably born on time. Might have been born early. Yeah. But most of us probably wouldn't have ever gotten that locker open. But Wanda did because, as some of you know, she could do a split and she could do contortionist moves with ease. And so she managed to get it open and get to class on time. So imagine that impressed Ronnie right there. Yeah. After a few more connections, they were in love. Wanda married Ronnie, the love of her life, during her last year of high school. As a married Air Force couple, they headed off to Amarillo, Texas. During their time in the Air Force, Ronnie's sister, Brynn, can't be here today, but she'll probably get to hear this. We got the bus at Sanders Auto Parts, Sanders Auto Parts, and we rode the bus all the way to Warner Robins, Georgia, to visit Ronnie and Wanda. And I remember we went to pick some wild blueberries she'd found out there and came back, and not surprisingly, she made a scrumptious pie. Yeah. From that seemingly meant-to-be marriage came two wonderful children, Wendy and Rhonda, grandchildren Hannah, Harley, and JT, along with son-in-laws. No, I didn't say wonderful there, Tony. Yep. Tony and Kevin. Kevin's wonderful. You are too, Tony, even though in that dance class he almost knocked me down a couple of times. Okay. Wanda was talented. In talking to people about their memories of Wanda, I learned what might have been the secret to that led our sixth grade girls basketball team to beat the other six girls basketball team. Sixth grade, we won. We beat them all. But also seventh grade teams, and it wasn't me. I was just mediocre, if even that. They had to have a certain number on there, though. But Wanda was a really good player, and I think her training might have started with a bushel basket that her cousin put up on the side of the barn. As a ninth grade basketball player, ninth grade, she's still playing basketball. She rode the activity bus with a locker trickster husband-to-be, Ronnie, but she didn't know he was a husband-to-be at the time. Yep. She was a great cook and a great seamstress. Both skills she got from her mother, Hazel. And show of hands if you can testify to her cooking or sewing skills. Yep.
Everybody
yep.
raised their hand.
Yep. She was a passionate teacher. When Wanda and Karen Mercer, don't start crying now, were team teaching at Trexler, they would spend a good chunk of summer vacation planning their coordinated projects for the upcoming year. We could be on a summer adventure. We were supposed to be enjoying we could go to the bathroom and the bell didn't even have to ring. But we might be browsing antique stores, junk stores, but they would be coming up with idea after idea after idea for projects for the next year. We could do this, or we could do that, or how about this? And so I wasn't even on their team. I wasn't even at their school. And you would think I would have said, cut this out. We're trying to have some fun around here. It's summer. But they were so excited, and it was so much fun that I really enjoyed it. And you can see, if you know Karen, you can see Wanda reeling it back in when the ideas were a little bit too complicated to try to pull off with middle schoolers in a set amount of time. Wanda had high expectations. She wasn't a quitter, But she didn't hold back. She wouldn't quit herself or anybody else. She didn't hold back on what she expected from her students, her family, or her friends. Right, Shelby?
Yep.
I'm not naming names, but I did hear that some very close to her might have at times held back on letting her know about assignments or upcoming projects because Wanda would be on them to start immediately. In her words, you never know what might happen to prevent finishing on time or doing your best. Even on family cruises, Wanda would remind them that in order to do the fun thing we plan, got to get prepared, get ready. She wanted people to do their best, and she wanted them to believe in themselves. Wanda was inclusive. She made sure that Rhonda's and then Kevin's inability to hear did not diminish their involvement in family or in the larger community. I think that may be one reason the grandchildren are so smart. They became bilingual, English and sign language, almost from birth. Wanda even included sign language as an extra for some of her classes at school. And my watching Wendy sign at Whaley's Chapel services and other activities made me wish that signing was more widespread. She loved finding roots and connections. She loved tracing genealogy and getting background stories on ancestors. She loved graveyards with connections to her family. One time she got fellow genealogist Dennis Jones to help find unmarked graves on a burial ground in Core Road, and then she made markers to honor them. She was a master at tracking down people who were connected to her in some way, just some way. She was also known for finding links with people who started out as strangers by just getting to know them in her genuine, sincere, friendly way. People like Stacy Williams, with whom she connected at the Piggly Wiggly Deli. I remember her excitement telling about showing Stacy a bunch of old, they were like at least 70 years old, maybe even more than that, pictures, photos from Northwest Bridge Road, where she grew up. And one of the photos had a picture of her aunts and uncles, I think it was, anyway, some grown-up relatives. And Stacy showed it to him. She held that one out to her laughs, and she said, "Do you recognize these people?" And it was two little black guys, and he immediately recognized it was him and his brother. He was so excited. And later, he told me that he thought Wanda had been looking for him a long time. It meant a lot to him. And that was the kind of thing she would do. I mean, you wouldn't want to go anywhere and be a big hurry to get away because she'd probably find somebody she knew. And then they'd start talking about history and how they were connected. Dennis just did that a minute ago. Okay, it's kin to her. She was an organizer. She would do her best to make it happen. Someone mentioned that a small tract of land on Northwest Bridge Road could possibly be used as a spot for gatherings for the family. And in a short period of time, the area was cleared, a 7,000-pound rock was added, a brass plate with names of grandparents and seven, I hope I'm getting this right now, and seven children were affixed to the stone, concrete pad was poured, concrete tables, benches, a swing set and a slide were added, and the whole thing was finished off with landscape rocks and crushed brick, and it just started with an idea that maybe we could do this. During the spring, she would start working on plans for Camp Vandermeer. Details, 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 details. Don't let me scare the person who's going to be doing this year, okay? About the many cogs in the wheel. And I love to hear her talk about those plans, even because I wasn't having to be involved in it, but even the plans a year when some of the buildings had been damaged by storms and they were having to figure out a way, and they were figuring out a way. But her detailed plans ensured that, along with a lot of built-in fun, Bible study would be at the heart of the week's activities. She was also involved in helping organize programs and events here at Whaley's Chapel. She was also a major organizer for a class of 66 reunions, and she'd be mighty happy to know that so many of y'all are here. The pack house gatherings, breakfast at Angie's, and family reunions, and just no telling what else. She was an organizer. And if I heard this from one person, I heard this from a lot of people. These very words, Wanda could work a room. Yep. And she loved to hug. It was true for our class reunions, and from what I hear, pretty much true anywhere her people were gathered. And by the way, just so you'll know, I have told Kenny that he probably is, you know, he got that breakfast at Angie's, and he may have to be the hugger. He's the host. Okay. She was observant. She was intuitive. She paid attention. She might say something like, I think something's bothering so-and-so. I think something might be wrong. They look kind of worried. Then she would connect them in a way that was not nosy, but showed that she was genuinely interested. And if they wanted to talk, she listened unconditionally. They could tell her anything. I think this was your word, I'm not sure. She was a nudger, not a judger. She loved us even when she didn't like what we were doing or maybe what we were failing to do. Instead of telling us directly what we ought to do or how we ought to change, she might put out some ideas to consider or ask some questions to help us think of a better response to a troublesome situation. And I'm so thankful that I was a recipient of her nudging many times, but I always knew when she was nudging me to do better because she loved me. She was a compassionate, loving angel to many. She'd call people and say, we're at the pig, this is what they have, what can we bring, what would you like? Or she'd just show up with food she knew they liked for friends or family that were kind of on a hard time physically. When a friend needed a place to stay to get through a really rough time, without even being asked, Wanda and Ronnie came up with a plan. They moved Rhonda into Wendy's room and moved their friend and child and cat into Rhonda's bedroom. And not only the bedroom, but according to the friend, into the whole family, the whole neighborhood. A friend of ours passed away recently after years in a nursing home facility. During her confinement and continuing after our friend's death, Wanda and Ronnie were always available to listen and encourage our friend's daughter. Not so long ago, I learned that a woman had been diagnosed with trigeminal neuralgia. I got the word out. The terrible condition that Wanda had endured. Immediately after, I told Wanda, and she called this woman, she called immediately that very day, I think, who was a stranger to her at the time. When this lady and I talked not too long ago, she talked about how grateful she was to have been at last able to talk to someone who really understood the condition and the excruciating pain it caused, and how grateful she was for the information she shared, that Wanda shared with her about treatment and the hope that Wanda gave her. She described Wanda as her sister in suffering. Wanda was truly a role model for living according to God's word. If anyone was cut out to be a minister's wife, it was Wanda. See, y'all, I told you we were opposites in a lot of ways. Okay. Yeah. Stories from friends and relatives showed over and over if there was a need, she didn't say like I would, well, if I get time or I hope I get time to do that, I'll do this and so, or I might like to. She would make time. One of her cousins said, Wanda was as good a woman as there's ever been. He also said, I don't know anyone who prays more. Listening to Wanda's friends and family talk about their experiences with her made me realize that while I had been counting on Wanda to stick around and get it done, get things done, keep helping us, whatever it was, that before she left, she had shown us her example of how to respond to people and challenges. She had shown us how to get it done. And now to a funny thing. Wanda could be funny. Her Facebook photo captures that twinkle in her eye. One summer, Hannah was accepted to a special week-long program near Washington, D.C. Wanda didn't want Hannah to be so far away without anyone nearby. She's pretty young, I think. Just in case, Wanda didn't want to spend a week by herself either, and she definitely didn't want to be driving around in Washington, D.C. in case Hannah could get out for dinner one night. She asked her nephew Hank to go with her. So for a week, Hank and Wanda took the metro or walked all over Washington, D.C. They had a great time. In talking about many of the things they saw and did, Hank told me a funny incident that happened. They got separated in one of the museums. Wanda called and told Hank, so I guess it was through phones, and she said she called and told him, I want to tell you that I'm not lost. I know we got separated, but I want to tell you I'm not lost. I wish I could do her voice right now. There's a sign right in front of me that says, you are here, so I'm not lost. Okay. So, yeah. So You can imagine the laughter in her voice and the twinkle in her eyes. She said it, just like that Facebook picture. Check that. That was her saying it. After all that, over years, whenever Hank or other family members came across the "You Are Here" sign, they'd send it to her and with a photo. And Hank just told me that story kind of near the end of when we're talking. But that story surprisingly became a message of peace from the Holy Spirit to my hurting heart. She is there. She's in heaven. And we knew she would be there. This led me to think that Wanda might want me to end with a reminder that she loves all of us, and she wants us all to join her in heaven. I believe she would want me to remind you that, as wonderful and as amazing as she was, it was not her good deeds and prayers that gave her eternal life in heaven. It was her faith in Jesus, God's Son, who came to earth, lived a sinless life, then allowed himself to be crucified as a pure and perfect sacrifice to cover our sins once and forever. And then after 3 days in a closed and guarded tomb, was resurrected and appeared to many to fulfill prophecy. It is Wanda's faith in Christ that reassures that she is there. She's not lost. She is there in heaven, waiting to greet us with that twinkle in her eye and to give us one of her famous hugs. Thanks.
We're going to code do this. We're here. We're going to sing.
We're going to sing. Hey, let's stand to our feet.
A couple of months ago, we had a business meeting, and in our business meeting, we motioned and voted to honor Ronnie and Wanda with a plaque that is held at our headquarters in Mount Olivet, the original Free Will Baptist headquarters. And we want to present this plaque to Ronnie and the family today. They don't get to keep it. It has to be presented at the headquarters in Mount Olivet, but we did ask the director if we could borrow it today just to present it to the family and let them see it. And at this time, I'm going to read what it says on it. Wall of Honor, Original Free Will Baptist. This recognition is in honor of the Reverend Ronnie Taylor and Wanda Taylor. In loving memory of Wanda and in deep appreciation of both Ronnie and Wanda in their Christ-like spirits and unselfish works for our Lord Jesus Christ. The Original Free Will Baptist and the congregation of Whaley's Chapel Church and the greater community. And that was given in their honor and memory of Whaley's Chapel Church congregation on April 11th, 2021, and we can't say enough. Okay. So, you want to go give it to him? I just told Miss Seeley we needed to have practiced a little bit better. Now we're going to take a short time, open mic night, if you want to call it that. Drew and Danielle are going to have some microphones. And if there's anyone in the congregation this afternoon that would like to say a few words about Wanda and her family, we would greatly appreciate you to do that at this time. Just raise your hand and wait for the microphone to come so we can get it on the recording. Anybody?
I'm going to be first because microphones and I don't get along and I might need some help here. And this is sort of redundant because I'm the trigeminal neuralgia sufferer that Susan mentioned, but she was afraid I wasn't going to get here, and I was afraid that I wasn't, so I wrote down what I wanted to say. So I'm going to read it. I've always been known to be able to make a short story long. So, some people come into our lives for only a season, but in that brief time make a profound difference. So it was with Wanda, who by chance, no, not by chance, but by God's grace, was introduced to me by Susan Thomas. Susan knew both of us were afflicted with trigeminal neuralgia, an extremely painful ailment. There was an instant connection between us, and it was a real comfort to talk to someone who truly understood the pain. You might say we bonded as sisters in suffering. We also connected as teachers, which sometimes was another form of suffering, but anyway, nevertheless, knowing Wanda and her devoted husband, Ronnie, is one of God's greatest gifts to me. I'll be forever grateful for their friendship. To emulate her goodness would be a fitting living legacy for Wanda. Rest in peace, dear friend. You live on in our hearts.
Amen.
I've had the honor and privilege to know Wanda for about 30 years. But honestly, I really didn't get a chance to really know her since I retired. I mean, we retired January the 1st, 2013 and moved back on the farm and started attending Whaley's Chapel Church. And that's when I really got to know Wanda Taylor and appreciate the woman that she was. She helped me in so many ways. I struggled at one time as to what I needed to do. And I scheduled time to go over and sit with Ronnie and talk with him about some of the things that were going through my mind. And Wanda was there, and Wanda sat down in a chair. And she listened, and Ronnie listened. And I was amazed that when I got through, it wasn't the words from Ronnie that soothed me, that set me back on my place, set me back in the straight. It was Wanda. Wanda sat and talked to me and filled me and gave me the things that I needed to move forward. So I'll always appreciate the time that I've had with her and all the time that she has taught me, whether it's here at Whaley's Chapel Church or if it was down at Camp Vandermeer. It was a wonderful experience to be able to know a woman of that caliber. And when I say caliber, I'm talking about Christ-like. Someone that walked the walk, they talked the talk, and they didn't mind teaching you how to follow. And I will always appreciate her for that fact. Thank you.
Anyone else? That's Tom.
Go ahead now. miss Miss Wanda, and she was my favorite teacher, and I love her.
My name's Tom Barbee, and these are my Thomas cousins on this row, and probably elsewhere in the congregation. But outside of my nuclear family, I think I've known Wanda just about longer than anybody in the world. We played in the yard together with Kenny. Marion's a little older, but we went fishing together with our mamas and our Grandma Thomas and Kenny and my sister. And we handed tobacco and looped tobacco and all those other pleasant tasks over the years. And I've always been blessed to call her my cousin, and she's like another sister when you get right down to it. But we look back on over time, and we see that Wanda fulfilled her calling as a teacher. It's obvious. And I guess, thinking about it, she knew how to catch a fish, if not here, over there, and not at this depth, but another depth. She knew how, and she could do it. She could do anything she set her mind to, and she did it willingly and with all her heart, as God calls us to do in Colossians. And she's epitomized in the lyric of a song Randy Travis made famous called Three Wooden Crosses, where he says, that teacher left her wisdom in the minds of lots of children and did her best to give them all a better start. Well, that's Wanda Taylor right there. Thank you.
Anyone else? Sandra.
This is on the humorous side of Wanda. Okay. She said that God had a sense of humor. She said that if you ask him for patience, he'll give you a reason to develop that patience.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else?
I promise I'm only going to say one little thing.
Susan, have you got your watch?
No, it's, I just remember certain things that she used to say all the time. She always had money that she had not spent yet. And if you ever asked her for a nickel or whatever it was, she said, well, I've got money I haven't spent yet. She would start each morning. We started with a little Bible study to get us started in school. We would pray on the day before the kids came, every desk. And the thing that was said about patience, I remember one time I was saying that I was, you know, that I was praying for the students. And one of them said, well, Miss Mercer, are you praying for me? And I said, well, yes, I am. He said, well, what are you praying for? I said, I'm praying I won't kill you. And it was because of the patience, you know, it was like, you never pray for patience, and that year I'd been praying, and boy, was there a group. And they would leave me and go to Wanda. On my 50th birthday, I knew it was going to be a special day, so she gave me a big basket of wonderful things. Cake mix, so I could make my own cake. Flower seed, so I could plant my own flowers. A big bag of balloons, because she said I was pretty full of hot air and I should be able to blow them up myself. But there's just so many memories. More than anything, it was about the children. We would take pictures of the children, put their pictures on the wall. We would have an end-of-the-month party to honor all the students we had. We would have grandparents and other special people day because Wanda was, that was her brainchild. We need to know our roots, and we need to appreciate those who have more wisdom than we do. And we need to know where we came from. Amen. And one last thing, we went to the archives one time, and we were looking up our family tree, and she was looking for someone named Makaja. And I was looking on my family tree, and I found someone named Makaja. And she says, "Oh no, say it isn't so." But anyway, I loved her like a sister. I miss her more than you never know. She was a dear friend. Amen.
Okay. I'd like to take just a moment of your time. I have to ask a question. Who in these two rows right here loves chicken salad? I guess my relationship, knowing Wanda Taylor, stretches back our whole marriage when we came here as newlyweds way back in the day, 40 some odd years ago. How many years was it? Anyway, y'all know Wanda Taylor loved to make chicken salad. She made it 10 pounds at a time. And I love Wanda Taylor. She always, whenever I came along and I showed an interest in her chicken salad, she always made me a little tub of it. And she would bring that to me, and that was very special to me. But I'm one of the ones that did not get to say goodbye. I had spoke to Wanda just briefly, because Ronnie and Wanda were both sick at the time. I spoke to her briefly, and at the same time, Sarah had COVID, and I was locked out of everything for 14 days. And today brings closure to me. It really does. You know, the norm is when somebody passes away that we mourn with the family. We have a visitation, we have a funeral, and we start remembering. A lot of us in here didn't get to do that. We didn't. It was like it was undone. So today, I feel so much better. Even though we're crying tears of joy, I feel so much better. And I'd like to thank the family. I really would.
So, Miss Wanda, so it won't be long before I will have been gone away from home longer than I was at home. You know, time flies, and it won't be long before I'll have been away from Whaley's Chapel longer than I was at Whaley's Chapel, because again, time flies. But when I do get home, and I did get to Whaley's Chapel, you know, I was reminded, somebody said Wanda could work a crowd, and I thought about a gift that she had that not unique to her, but nonetheless very powerful, very special gift that she had. And that was her, I guess, related to her ability to work a crowd. She never, ever failed. Not once in all the times that I had the opportunity to come back and visit and be at home, come to church, never once failed to make me feel loved. Amen. And to make me feel welcome, and to make me feel like I had not been away from home. I'm going to miss that and miss her very terribly. But look forward to seeing her again one day.
I'm Marion Howard. Wanda's father and my mother were brothers and sisters. So that's how Howard got in the Thomas family. But Wanda was the most outgoing, loving, giving, talented person I ever met. And she was the love of my cousins that I thought so much of. My grandmother had some antiques, and Wanda had a lot of them. And Wanda gave them to me to go in my museum. And I was so thankful for that, because it tied me back to my grandmother. And I remember Ronnie saying one time that if Wanda was fixing to leave, he wanted her to wait to pack his bags. But she was a great, great person, and she'll be remembered as that. And thank you for the time to talk.
You're welcome, sir.
I first met Wanda 14 years ago on Easter Sunday. Robin invited me to the Pack House for family dinner. And you all know how well or how much Wanda liked to get to know people. Well, I got cornered in the Pack House by Wanda and Janice Carter and Faye Kennedy. And, you know, even though I was a Yankee, they welcomed me in. But I talked to the three of them in the corner for about an hour and a half after dinner. And Robin and I think we had dated, once before that. And Wanda basically said, you'd be good to her. And, you know, here we are 14 years later. So she's a good woman.
Amen. Anybody else? If not, then I'd like to ask Kevin to come up, please.
I'm sure most of us have heard the phrase that time heals all wounds. Well, time can't heal much of anything. It's God that heals our wounds. What time does is it robs us of our ability to remember. And as human beings, we always like to try to fix things and come up with ways to solve issues as this. So one thing we do to try to help us remember is we make something a symbol. A symbol is just something that we can see that through association, it represents something that we can't see. One example that we all are aware of is a rose. The rose is a symbol of love. If you don't believe it, look around at the florists on Valentine's Day at all the roses that are sent out. That's where we are giving people these roses to express and show the love we have for them. Jesus, during his ministry, even used symbols. If you recall back when he was at the Last Supper, he used the bread and the cup as a symbol of his broken body and his shed blood, but also it was a symbol of the great love that he had for us, and he gave himself as that sacrifice to pay for our sins. And we still use those symbols today in our communion services to remember Jesus and the love he has for us. So today, I'm sure all of us here want to remember this day and all the memories and the love and the life of Miss Wanda for as long as we can. And I'm sure the family especially wants to do that. So to help them, we're going to present them with a symbol. This symbol is a rose, a bush. We're going to give one to Ronnie, one to Wendy, one to Rhonda. Now, as I've already said, a rose is a symbol of love. But we're going to attach some other responsibilities to these bushes. They're also going to be representative of Miss Wanda's life, so that in the future, anytime when y'all start feeling like you're forgetting something, you can look at these bushes, and not just these, but any roses for that matter, and I pray that it'll remind you of Miss Wanda and the great love that she had for each one of us and her great life that she had here and shared with us. So at this time, my helpers would. On behalf of the church and family and friends and everyone here, we'd like to present you with a rose bush. They don't have any flowers on them today. They've already bloomed, but they'll be blooming again shortly. I pray that God will bless these bushes, that they'll grow and last a long time, and they'll always cause you to remember Miss Wanda. Thank you.
Let us all stand. We're going to sing another song. This will be What a Day That Will Be.
One more tribute I'd like to read, and this is from Robin Taylor Sykes, Wanda's niece. And she wrote it the day that she passed away. And it says, "What do you say when your heart is broken? Mine is broken today. My dear Aunt Wanda gained her wings today, and we lost her. For that I am sad. Those who knew her know she was one of a kind. She spent most of her life with the love of her life, marrying my Uncle Ronnie. her high school sweetheart while still in high school. Over the years, she was an Air Force wife, a farmer's wife, a mother, a college student while also being a wife and mother, a teacher, an aunt, and for the last several years, a preacher's wife. One other thing she was a sister. She was an only child, as was my mother. But they became sisters-in-law and remained sisters-in-love. Anyone who ever had her as a teacher knows she was a great teacher. And really, if you knew her, then you were most likely her student. She had a knack for teaching you something without you ever knowing it was a lesson. She also loved to make connections. Whenever she would meet someone new, she would take the time to really get to know them. She would ask about their people, and she would almost always find some connection to that person. From that point on, they were part of her circle. If you were in her circle, she made sure she knew what was going on with you too. If she had questions, she would ask them. If any young man came calling, kind of Mark's already alluded to this, on any of the young girls in her circle, she would surely ask him questions until she felt comfortable with him. Even when the girls weren't so young. Right, Mark? One thing you always knew was that she loved you because she always said it to you. She wouldn't let long periods of time pass without being in contact with you. The last time I spoke to her was last Wednesday before her passing. She was already sick, but what she said was, "Ronnie sounds worse than I do. Please pray for him and pray for us." And she said, "I love you," before she hung up. I'm glad I had the opportunity to talk to her and hear her that day. And I think that's a great tribute, Robin. And now, Ronnie's asked me to read some words from him. I appreciate so much the heartfelt prayers and comments that my family has received during this difficult time. Without family and friends such as you, we would have had a much more difficult time. God blessed me with this woman and allowed me to be one with her for 55 years and 4 months. Although we were young when married, she 17 and I 19, we were determined to make it work. Many folks said this will not last, but it did. We were a couple from our very first date on February the 2nd, 1964, until she went to be with the Lord. That totals up to be 57 years and 1 week, or 20,827 days. Now, I know Wanda liked that. She had to have liked that. Wanda was a very frugal wife with our finances, or lack thereof, early in our marriage, and that in itself was a great blessing. It kept us going. She kept me in check when I would come up with a harebrained idea or whatever. God blessed us with 2 wonderful daughters. She was always so proud of them. Then came our sons-in-law, and to her, they were hers too. And on the grandchildren, you grandparents, you know what I mean when I say that. Wanda loved family, whether it was my family, her family, or our church family. She was always ready to do whatever was necessary to ascertain unity and love were present. After my stint in the military and a couple of years of working on the farm, Wanda for the first time told me she had always dreamed of teaching at Richland Schools. So she became a teacher, and what a teacher she was. She loved her students and tried to make sure that each and every one of them learned as much as possible. She touched so many lives throughout her career. She also touched many lives through her love and caring for others. She knew so many people on a first name basis because she took the time to know them and to care for them. Pardon my rambling, and I will close with this. 17 years ago, I felt the call of the Lord on me to go into the ministry. When I expressed my feelings to Wanda, her comment was, "Well, it is about time you answered his call." And that's Wanda. I mean, she's straightforward, even with Ronnie. says here, from that day forward, she became what I would call the epitome of a pastor's wife. She was deeply concerned about the welfare of the church family, but she never forgot about the lost people around her. She didn't mind telling me when I did not do so well with a sermon, but she did not hesitate to pat me on the back either when I hit the mark. She was my confidant and sounding board throughout my life, and how I miss her. Again, I say a big thank you to all of you for the cards, words, prayers, and the donations in her memory to the church. The amount of donations was extraordinary and will be put to use to help the church in any way they determine it is needed. God bless you all. Revelations 22:20, even so, come, Lord Jesus. And all I can say in closing, I'm going to ask Brother Wayne Moore to come up and do our closing prayer and blessing of our refreshments. She is gone, but we will see her again. And that's it.
If you will, please bow your heads. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, oh Lord, for this day. We thank you for the privilege of being able to come in and celebrate the life of Wanda Taylor. We know, dear Lord, that you have her lifted up high. We know, dear Lord, that she's with you and that she is a beam of light even there. She was a beam of light for so many here in this church that followed her each and every day, that looked to her and turned to her for advice, for love, for cherishing. She was a very loving person. We thank you, oh Lord, for that time and the privilege that we had to be able to share her on this earth. But we also know, just like Wanda Taylor knows, that one day, each and every one of us that are a child of God will be joining her before that throne of Almighty God. We thank you again, O Lord, for the privilege of knowing her and being able to share her life here on this earth. Now, dear Lord, as we conclude this celebration of life, we ask as we get together and socialize here in this church that we continue to share these memories that we have with one another. And we ask, dear Lord, that you bless the food that we're about to receive and that each one of us receives nourishment and that we will bind our lives to you to use that strength to carry it forward. A beacon, if nothing else, for Wanda Taylor. These things we ask in your blessed and holy name. Amen.